Spain. Let's get this, let's continue this conversation, and we're going to try to take this budget to the market straight place and see what we can do with it. Robert Omotunde is starting this for us this morning. He's the head of research at AfriInvest West Africa. Good morning.
Good morning, boss.
It's good to have you.
Thank you.
This is a very interesting time, but let's start with this President Buhari's State of the Nation. What he gave yesterday was more of a State of the Nation address rather than a budget presentation, because he spoke very broadly on security, the Niger Delta cleanup. He spoke about currencies. He spoke about the progress being made in the power sector. He spoke about agriculture. He touched almost on everything that's supposed to be on this table. Give us your take. Let's kick it off.
Well, I think what the president tried to do yesterday was going beyond the numbers, because if you know, the budget preparation for any country is meant to address key issues that the country may be facing, you know. And when the president comes up and presents the budget, what he's basically trying to do is trying to address key areas of macroeconomic focus. So what he tried to do yesterday was trying to go down the memory lane, how we have fared, you know, especially since he took up office. You know, you remember that he had some health challenges at the beginning of the year, you know, but again, how the economy basically fared in terms of security, like you mentioned, you know, in terms of the restiveness that we once had in the Niger Delta, which has been sort of stamped down, you know, in terms of what how the budget has performed, especially for 2017. You know, even tried to delve into 2016 and how the budget performed when he was mentioning that we were able to do about 1.2 billion naira in capital project. So I think what the president did yesterday was in order, you know, trying to lay the background before now presenting the budget for 2018, which we agree with some of the assumptions, or most of the assumptions, although we have some issues to address when we drill down into
the president numbers. Didn't say much about 2017 budget, yep, because that's look like work in progress,
yep,
where we're putting another yam in the fire. Correct. In the manner of speaking.
Correct.
From this point of this part of the world.
Mm-hmm.
But basically speaking, this is what the president calls a budget of consolidation.
Yep.
It was President Goodluck Jonathan that had a budget of consolidation. So this is President Buhari's version of consolidation. What sort of consolidation do you think President Buhari is doing? Do you think he's trying to consolidate this economic position and performance ahead of 2019 budget here with what he rolled out yesterday?
Yes, I think, yeah, where I think they would have coined, or the president would have coined that term from, consolidation, you know, is from the fact that when this government took office, remember, the first budget that was presented by the Buhari administration, you know, there was this concept of zero-based budgeting, you know, that was introduced. But again, the economy was challenged when we slipped into recession, and it became clear that the government would need to put up some expansionary policy, you know, in terms of spending. So what we've seen from 2016 to 2017 and now this 2018 budget has been incremental, you know, budgeting in terms of expenditure. When you look at the nominal expenditure, you know, in terms of budgeting. So what I think the Buhari administration is trying to, I mean, the coinage for consolidation is coming from, he's trying to, you know, address the fact that this budget is still a continuum. We've seen the release of the Economic Recovery and Growth Plan. You know, we've seen the medium-term expenditure framework taking a cue from that growth plan, you know, and then we are seeing a 2018 budget basically coined out of the medium-term expenditure framework. For us, that's a very standard way of budgeting when you know that the economy has a clear-cut plan from the ERGP, which is a medium-term plan anyways, you know, but you see the MTF also taking a cue from it, and then the budget is now, you know, being appropriated, because, you know, the budget will have the backing of the law to support the plan.
The president says yesterday, and part of his opening remarks was that, thank you so much, you multilateral agencies, for giving us some suggestions about how to handle our economy, mm-hmm, but we're going to use homegrown solutions to our homegrown problems. Do you agree with the president on that?
Well, I think using the homegrown solution, if I understand what the president is trying to say, is that the Nigerian economy is peculiar, right? It may not be appropriate to apply all the so-called conventional policies to tackling our own problem. But the president cannot also shy away from the reality of the global economy and how your economy cannot operate in isolation, right? And but we've seen the current government trying to, you know, implement policies. I mean, one of the issues that we've always mentioned that is putting the Nigerian economy, you know, at a disadvantage are our structural issues. And we've seen a lot of efforts being put into this, especially in 2017. You know, the result that we saw, moving up 24 places in the ease of doing business ranking, you know, is a testament to, you know, what the government is trying to do in terms of structurally, you know, rearranging the economy and how the global economy
sees us. The issue about the structural problems with the economy is, was part of what Moody's talked about. I'm sure you've seen this overnight, that the government's balance sheet remains structurally exposed to further economic and financial shocks. Interest payments are still very high relative to our revenue, and deficits elevated despite cuts in capital spending. Mm-hmm. We have a lot to talk about. Stick around. Yeah. Robert Omotode is here with us till 1:30 the hour. When we come back, we're expanding the conversation base. Stick around. We're back in. It's going to be a long conversation starting since yesterday around the budget 2018 presentation and the State of the Nation addressed by President Muhammadu Buhari. Everyone, we thank you very much for being part of the program. This is your Business Morning. Let's expand this conversation. Robert Omotode, who is the head of research at AfriInvest, is live here in the studio with us. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you,
for being here. And let's bring in into the conversation economist and chief executive officer at financial derivatives company, Bismarck Rewani. Mr. Rewani, thank you very much. We appreciate your time.
Good morning, Boston.
Well, while we were still scratching our heads yesterday, lunchtime, around the budget presentation and the State of the Nation address, Moody's Investor Services, just around when we're closing business and going home for the day, Moody's cut Nigeria's sovereign issuer rating to B2. Now, let's start from this negative part of the conversation. I'm sure you've seen that report. Do you think this was in line, or part of it was in line, with what the budget ought to address?
Yes, it is true that it was downgraded, but what's more important is the outlook. The outlook is maintained as stable, but the credit rating is downgraded because there are some fundamental problems that need to be resolved. So, like I told you earlier in our discussion, Nigerians make progress synonymous with success. The fact that you're progressing does not mean that you're successful. The fact that your score has increased from 25 to 30% does not mean that you've hit the pass mark, but it's 30% better than 25%, but you really need to get to the pass mark. So you go back to the budget and what you said, the State of the Nation speech. The president made a State of the Nation speech. However, if you take a look at the budget and extricate what you call political sound bites from that discussion, because we are in an electoral cycle, you'll find that we have a total expenditure that has increased by 15.7% at a time when inflation is at 15.9%. So essentially and effectively, you have actually expanded your expenditure by 0% in real terms. So we must differentiate between effective and nominal values, which is so that we don't confuse the public. And what the public wants to know, what the ordinary man on the street wants to know, is that what is the impact of all of these announcements and all these numbers being thrown all over the place on my life? That is where, is it going to create full employment? Far from it, it's not going to happen. Two, is it going to create price stability? Yes, it's moving in that direction. And thirdly, and most importantly, is it, as a tool of economic management, is it going to actually make us competitive and change the narrative from being protectionist to being competitive? I think those are the key things that we need to ask ourselves. Finally, I want to stress something which is important, that some of those parameters which are being used, $23 billion is the total budget amount. As a percentage of GDP, that is minuscule. It's not going to make that impact. So you need to be audacious. You need to be bold. You need courage, vision, and integrity to get to the promised land here. So instead of $23 billion, maybe you're talking about something twice that amount. But then the discipline of spending, which the president emphasized, it's important. The discipline should be there, but that does not mean we should be constrained. We need to deal with our problems. The stimulus has to be impactful before you begin to consolidate. You cannot consolidate with marginal progress.
And that's a very interesting conversation, Mr. Rwani, about consolidation here. Robert, consolidation is a very key word when you consolidate. From an organizational point of view, when you consolidate, in 2017 budget was that of economic recovery, was that of recovery and growth. Then, while that budget is just 5 months old, we're having another baby called consolidation.
Well, I think, to be clear, remember, the president mentioned that only about $450 billion has been expended on capital projects for 2017 budget. So the 2017 budget is still running and is perhaps still going to run till about May or thereabouts. Now, what this consolidation means is that some of the projects that were highlighted in 2017 has more or less been carried forward into 2018 budget, you know, with the assumption that for instance, the president was saying that they're expecting to spend up to 50% of the 2017 budget before the year runs out. So from $450 billion, we are still expecting another $500 billion or thereabouts, you know, before the end of the year, because the capital budget for 2017 was around $2
trillion. So you're looking at about a trillion naira.
Yes, now, at the end of the year.
We've done $450 billion spending between June and October. Mm-hmm. Now we expect to spend $500 billion within the next 50 days.
Yeah. Well, that's what the president said. Now, if that happens...
Is that practical?
Well, you know, I think it's practical, you know, especially given the recovery that we've seen in terms of oil prices.
Yes, the money,
you know,
will be
there. And the revenue.
But
of
throwing $500 billion into the economy in just about 6 weeks, that's a very... very interesting to think about how we're going to manage that size of money in this in an economy.
Remember that these monies will be thrown into capital projects, you know, and when you expend on capital project, you know, or when you make approval, you know, and you give 500 billion naira for a project, it might be like 50%, you know, down payment for completion.
Approval. Approvals, then we have releases from the central bank, because you got to release the money.
Correct.
To the contractors. Yep. If you approve 500 billion mm-hmm. and the money does not touch the hands of the contractors, you haven't released much. Bismarck, Mr. Rwani, help us out here on this.
No, because that's why I'm trying to differentiate between a budget of completion and a budget of consolidation. With all due respect, Robert, you have to understand that there's what we call the absorptive capacity of an economy. What Boston is talking about is how can you compress 500 billion naira or whatever it is, 1 trillion naira in 6 weeks for what you are going to do over 12 months. And then over and above that, you start the CapEx for 2018 again. So you might suffer from what we can call economic indigestion if you are not careful, because you are just rushing these things. It is the impact and the way you are going to do it over time. And I'm saying that we should differentiate between spending and investment. What we are going to be emphasizing in 2018 is investment, not just spending and consumption. And with that, you begin to have the desired impact. And the desired impact in such a way that it begins to alter consumer behavior and investor behavior and perception. That is where we are going. And I'm saying, with all respectfully, that 0.5% growth in Q2 and probably 1% growth in Q3 is not successful enough to begin to consolidate. We need to expand it, we need to increase the stimulus, and we need to get it much more focused than just celebrating mini successes.
Mr. Wall, thank you very much. Robert, in terms of what we've seen as the five big sectors, the top five, that will be getting the lion's share of the 2018 appropriations. If we do a simple math, these five ministries will be accounting for close to $2 trillion or thereabout of the total. So, do you think this is the way to go to consolidate?
Well, I think that if you analyze those sectors, you know, in terms of the projects that are to be executed, so you have the power sector, power, works and housing. We must not forget, you know, it's about three ministries that have been fused into one. right? And a lot of projects, you know, have been carried out since the beginning of this administration. The president touched on it. You know, we have a transmission capacity that has been enhanced from about 5,000 megawatts to about 7,000 megawatts. And so many projects are ongoing. You know, you touched on the Mambela project, which the president also mentioned that 2018 budget is going to focus on. Transportation sector, we talked about a lot of infrastructure issues that this country is currently facing, you know, and the government has been trying as much as possible to tackle this. The 2018 budget, you know, or even the 2017 budget, you know, was part of the strategy that the government was trying to use, you know, to also address infrastructure. You know, we've seen a lot of partnership with the private sector. We note the project that is currently ongoing at the Apapa Wharf, you know, which is a private sector initiative, you know, in exchange for tax credit, you know, the government is doing. Of course, the government will have to understand that a lot of private sector initiatives have to be put in place in terms of tackling our you know, infrastructure issues. So I do not think that these sectors have too much. Transportation is a major issue for this country. You know, we need to talk about how to develop our rail, you know, improve our road infrastructure, even, you know, talk about alternative means of moving goods and people around. You know, we cannot overemphasize this. So I do not think they are getting too much.
Let's take this budget to the marketplace, Mr. Rawane, and let's start with you with the assumptions. The inflation, 12.4%, that's what the fiscal authorities are looking at. The central bank is looking at a single digit in 2018. Look at that for us, as far as then the exchange rate consideration for this budget as well. Let's get what you call the devils in the details.
Now, the inflation target is reasonable. 12.4% inflation target is within shouting distance. We are at 15.9 now, and I think that once we have aggregate output increasing, we will see some progress. For correction, the central bank target is 11% for 2017, and the objective over that period is to make it single digit, which means anything between 0 and 9.9. However, that is realistic. The exchange rate of 305 is not. That's a nominal rate. The effective rate of exchange today is 360 to 363. 305 is not; it's only distortionary, and that has to be addressed, because you know, the exchange rate is a rate at which the states and the federal government is going to be converting their dollars to naira. And you are saying that the states cannot pay their salaries, yet they are being given 305 instead of 360. If you make it 360, then fiscal consolidation will take place. That's number one. But also, we must understand something which is extremely important here, that the level of growth being anticipated is 3.5%, which is quite aggressive. And if we can achieve 3.5% growth rate, I think then we would have achieved significant, then we would, the growth rate would be higher than the population growth rate, and we begin to feel the impact. So generally speaking, I think the assumptions on the price of oil is very conservative. $45 is 44% below the spot price today. The production of 2.3 million barrels, if you include condensates, is fairly fair value. But what nobody is talking about is that this budget is silent. The budget is silent on subsidies. The subsidy is the big elephant in the room. If the numbers we hear are right, the subsidy items could be as much as 1.2 trillion naira, which is already over 20% of the entire budget. And it's about 50% of the budget deficit. So we cannot be silent on the question of subsidies, petroleum subsidies in this budget.
Robert, let's take this budget to the street. What's on the market street, for this, in terms of how do you think investors will begin to think through this budget right now as to where's the government spending money, where am I going to make, where's the likely interest rate direction will be if nothing moves at the November 2021 MPC, at least by January 2018?
Well, for us, one of the things that we've highlighted is the fact that the government is making efforts to reduce the portion of borrowing from the domestic market, you know, and you will note that in this budget, it was even highlighted that from the current level of 79% domestic borrowing, you know, we're going to see a gradual reduction, which is already being done, to 60%, so that foreign borrowing account for about 40%. The import of this is that the crowding out of the private sector, which we've always talked about, you know, we're going to see some, you know, mitigation into that. If the federal government is not as dominant in the domestic bond market, especially, you know, then even in the treasury bills market, then we'll begin to see the opportunities for the private sector to come in, you know, and issue credits at a much more, you know, lower rate. We are expecting and looking forward to the time when we will have an active domestic corporate bond market. As we speak, we do not have an active domestic corporate bond market. You know, what we have is the federal government dominating the space. In terms of infrastructure spending, you know, we're going to see a lot of of the sectors on the exchange benefiting. The industrial goods sector, of course, is going to benefit from the allocation that have been given to the power works and housing,
you know, and, of course, transportation.
Of course, transportation.
That's a lot of money in there. You're looking at close to 800 billion.
Yeah. Then even from the recurrent expenditure, because if you look at the recurrent expenditure line, you know, that's a line of expenditure that the government always almost score 100%. You know,
in terms of performance.
In terms of performance.
Because that's simply, you know, salaries and wages.
You know, so you see, salaries and wages.
Once everybody gets paid.
Yes, salaries and wages. But the impact is that, you know, when people don't get salaries, you know, they can't spend. You know,
that's another
when there is no spending, you know, the economic activities will be constrained.
So
spending makes the economy, you know,
money answer it all, then. Don't it?
Yes.
Thank you. It does. Thank you very much for coming through. Robert Amon today, the head of research at AfroInvest.